My name is R. Crosby Lyles, and this is News from the Can. One of the most annoying things about climate news from some sources is that they are always trying to disprove the effect of CO2 with incidental weather events around the world. I don't personally give a damn about the politics of carbon emissions. I want to know what is most likely to happen next. Accurate forecasting means that all possible forces must be analyzed and factored in. That means that Henrik Svensmark effects get added in with Milankovitch cycles along with CO2, methane, NO2, sulfur emissions, and any other reasonable possibility. And no possible effects or attendant theories should be discarded out of hand just because the person or persons who put it forward are not well esteemed by the scientific community. The often disregarded Art Bell and Whitley Strieber and the coming global superstorm is the first place I had ever heard of stratospheric intrusion, and that was a long time ago. Their analysis was tight and should be recognized in spite of their purported lack of credentials. On the other hand, carbon deniers lose credibility because of the vast potential profit and loss for fossil fuel producers. Paid shills and purveyors of fear porn are a dime a dozen on the internet. I suppose that sooner or later everyone comes to Jesus on the Titanic, though. Why wait? Here's the meat. From Arctic Warming, Scientist Alarmed by Crazy Temperature Rises by Jonathan Watts, Global Environment Editor at TheGuardian.com, this week, quote, some scientists speak of a hypothesis known as warm Arctic cold continents as the polar vortex becomes less stable, sucking in more warm air and expelling more cold fronts, such as those currently being experienced in the UK and Northern Europe. Rohde notes that this theory remains controversial and is not evident in all climate models, but this year's temperature patterns have been consistent with that forecast. Now watch this graphic of the 2-meter temperature anomaly, GFSCFSR 2MT anomaly, at Arctic temperatures surge in the dead of winter by Kara Fox and Brandon Miller at CNN.com. And it's easy to see how seawater warms the air and landlocked continental regions cool it off. It's almost as if the polar vortex has been replaced by a pinwheel of alternating hot and cold temperatures with its center of rotation south of the pole over Baffin Island, Canada. Besides the equalization of temperature between the North Pole and lower latitudes causing the collapse of the polar vortex, the difference between the heat capacity of water and the colder land masses creates a pressure differential that may drive airflow in alternative directions. The possible good news is that there may be some predictability in the new weather regime. The bad news is that precipitation may become more severe and prolonged. Storage capacity of energy in an oscillating system like the Earth generally causes a shift in phase of a waveform, meaning later and shorter winters. Because the temperature of the land changes faster than water, air masses can flow in puffs that may create rapidly changing hot and cold conditions. However, this also may allow for high and low pressure ridges to set up regular, predictable locations like the high pressure zones this winter over the Gulf of Mexico, the North Atlantic off of Greenland, and the North Pacific off of Alaska, as well as that fairly persistent low pressure region over Baffin Island. And as we watch this GFS model, it's easy to see that Baffin Island is basically like a new quasi-polar center of circulation. Here's the bottom line. The new circulation regime may end up being continent-centered instead of pole-centered. As the polar vortex breaks up, new smaller vortices may emerge to take its place. This may allow for moisture transport and precipitation to become seasonally locked into certain positions. And has been repeated ad nauseum on this channel, with that scenario comes the possibility for catastrophic amounts of snowfall. Before we close, a quick word about the planet killer. As I've stated in several previous videos, my belief is that the planet killer is sulfur emissions. The Permian-Triassic extinction and the PETM were most likely caused by the introduction of H2SO4 from volcanic sulfur emissions, which caused CO2 to be released from carbonic compounds in the oceans. It seems like a lot of people believe that somehow CO2 caused the acidification of the oceans, which is a deep subject that involves ocean circulation and some novel ideas about capacity related to temperature and pressure at depth. Not trivial. We will talk about it more in later videos. Ultimately, though, I believe that is impossible, because if we were to saturate the oceans with CO2, the lowest pH we would get is about 5.6. This circumstance would only happen after every living thing on planet Earth was dead. H2SO4, on the other hand, has a pH of 0. The oceans had the acidity of lemon juice during the Permian-Triassic extinction, and 30% of terrestrial life survived. Clearly, CO2 emissions were the ultimate cause of those changes in the climate, but the source of those emissions was probably from sulfuric acidification. Back in the 80s, half of all sulfur emissions came from human industrial activity. Lakes died and the land suffered from acid rain until we began regulating sulfur content in fuels and scrubbing coal smoke from power plants. Stratospheric aerosol shading from sulfur compounds may cool the earth for a little while, but those acid-producing particles settle in a matter of days. Once the pH of the ocean changes, it may take years for it to bounce back, and the damage can be irreversible. Just in case anyone out there was thinking that somehow sulfur in the stratosphere was a good idea. Anyway, that's it for now. If you want a break from reality, I suggest watching the movie The Shape of Water, directed by Guillermo del Toro and released back in December of 2017. It's a masterpiece. Del Toro is nothing less than a miracle worker for producing such an incredible experience on a tiny budget. It's a $100 million production done for a fraction of that cost. No BS. It's amazing. I don't get paid. These people don't pay me to tell you this. I'm telling you this just because I watched it today, and it's really amazing. It's just a work of art. It's a masterpiece. And I'm just blown away by it. Anyway, that's it for now. My name is R. Crosby Lyles, and this has been News from the Can. Thanks for watching. News from the Can.